A good day to all of you, and welcome to the show Living Multiculturalism with Mayank Bhatt. You're watching Tag TV. The program is brought to you by the Canadian Thinkers Forum. Friends, today we have with us a poet who's been with us in Canada for the last 6 years. She's from Iran. Bänoo Zan has recently published her first collection of poems and has been organizing a very vibrant and multicultural poetry recitation program once a month in Toronto. Welcome to the show, Bänoo.
Thank you, and I would like to greet your audiences as well. I'm so happy to be on the show, to be with every one of you.
So let's talk about what your experience has been working, living in Canada for the last 6 years, being a poet. We claim to be a multicultural society. What has been your experience?
Well, I landed in 2010, and within the first month of landing, I started going to different events. And so I've been going to more events than probably a lot of people who have lived here all their lives. And I deliberately pushed myself, and I explored, and I still do. I explored diverse events. And to my amazement, I discovered that there are, you know, bubbles, or, you know, the literary scene, or the poetry scene more specifically, is very segregated around lines such as ethnicity, age, sexual orientation, nationality, religion, age even, and poetic styles and voices and visions. And at some point, I don't know when it happened, that it just dawned on me that, you know, I know these people from different communities. They don't know one another. So let's start, you know, a poetry reading series, an open mic, where they can explore the beauty of the other's work and the other's contributions to poetry or to art. And so I started it in November 2012.
What did you call it?
Shab-e-sher, that's Persian word. And I actually chose this word because it is not English and because it is not even European. So Shab means night in Persian, and sher in Arabic and Persian means poetry. So Iranians or Persian speakers call these gatherings Shab-e-sher. So if you tell them, I'm going to Shab-e-sher, they're going to assume it's going to be in Persian. But it's the only Shab-e-sher in the whole world that is in a language other than Persian. Though we also encourage people reading or reciting in different languages.
And for how long have you been doing this?
Since November 2012. So we're getting close to 4 years now.
The other point that, you know, it's great that you started something of this kind that brings together, you know, people from different ethnicities and different backgrounds who are also poets to come and, you know, meet and recite poetry at one place. But you're also a poet yourself. Mm-hmm. And you've done some tremendous amount of great poetry over the last 6 years that you've been here. I was privileged enough to hear you for the first time when you read with at Farzana's
Brockton Writers Series.
Yes. And so what has been your experience as a poet working in a multicultural society?
When I landed, actually, you know, nobody expected me to stay here for such a long time, because I really loved Iran, and I was depressed for the greatest part. And but you know, and I was looking for a job and wasn't finding any, so poetry was my only connection to the outside world, the only meaningful connection. So for me, it became really kind of an urgent issue. Like, it wasn't just a luxury for me. For me, it was just a medium through which I could find people with whom I had things in common to talk about. And but I discovered myself as an outsider to whatever society or community that existed here and exists here and work here. Whichever poetry group or event I went to, I was an outsider, you know. And it took a while for the people to connect with me. And, you know, people here are a bit conservative, you know, take a long time. They observe you and they keep their distance from you. They offer you alliance, they don't offer you friendship. So for me, even now, if you ask me, the biggest challenge any newcomer faces, for me, it's friendship. It's not even jobs or financial security. It's that kind of loneliness that I had no idea it could ever exist. And so maybe it helped me in my poetry. I discovered that anything that's bad for me as a person is good for me as a poet. It makes me write more. But you know, I'm not like tempting fate right now. So but through this process of like finding yourself an outsider, I discovered things about myself that I didn't know. I rediscovered my identity. I discovered aspects of me, and I actually kind of came to terms with aspects of my identity that I couldn't when I was back in my homeland. So I became more of an Iranian, more of a Muslim, more of kind of connected to my roots, more appreciative of the beauty of the culture I came from when I was distanced from it.
You know, this is problematic for me. Mm-hmm. And I want to explore this even more.
Sure.
When you say that you rediscovered your roots, a lot of people who come here claim this. And I've noticed that they then kind of rest their critical faculties completely and begin to blindly accept whatever their home culture has to offer. I find that to be unacceptable, because if you have decided to be here in a multicultural society, you don't belong to just one culture any longer, mm-hmm. right? What has been your experience in that?
I guess I'm still very critical of my home culture, and I'm critical, but you know, I also am very critical of whatever context you put me in. That's why probably I wouldn't end up in heaven, you know. So and I think that, you know, once you are critical, and if you are a true artist, art means critique of the mainstream culture, whatever your mainstream is. When I was in Iran, I was very critical of the culture. Here, again, I'm very critical. And I was talking to Taher just, you know, half an hour ago, that I'm very critical of the Iranian community.
In Canada?
In Canada. And I'm also very critical of the mainstream culture of Canada. I'm also very critical of the different ethnic groups that exist. So I'm critical of everybody.
And are you critical enough? Are you critically observing your own development?
Yes, I
am. As a person and as a poet?
Yes, I am. Yeah.
And what does that lead you to? What kind of conclusion does that lead you to?
Well, you know what? If you are alone, like if one of the things that you miss are here, is friendship, in the sense that a true friend can stand like you are doing right now. Can confront you and say, you know what, I don't accept what you are saying. I think you are making no sense. But when you are alone, like my experience, you become your own most important critic, because no one else is performing that job for you. So, and you spend a lot of time observing yourself, and I think that it pushes me. You know, like a lot of times it pushes me to find ways to improve myself and to improve my performance and to improve my art, as well as, you know, my social function as a poetry curator. Because you know, kindness is a sign that people are not still very, very close to you. You know, they just give you positive feedback. And so, yes. And I think I've always been my most important critic, because the issues that are uppermost in my mind, are the issues that, you know, am I, like, these are the questions that are important for me. Am I really honest with myself? Am I really brave enough to express whatever uncomfortable thoughts or emotions come in me, you know, or visit me? So, like, when I'm writing poetry, I don't consciously decide that, you know what, now I'm going to write a poem about Iranian identity. This never happens to me. The first draft comes to me, like the muse visits me, urges me to write. And then when I, sometimes it even surprises me, like I'm writing and I'm thinking, is this me writing that? I can't believe I'm writing this. Like, if 10 years ago anybody would tell me that, you know, one day you would be writing about these issues, I wouldn't be even able to, like, politely just smile, you know? So I've developed so much, or I've come so far. I'm happy to even discover myself. It's just like when I tell people I'm in my Alice in Wonderland mood, they think I'm just exploring the outside culture and the outside world. That's not what I mean. I mean also like Alice in Wonderland in my inner land, and I'm discovering, okay, there are places that I hadn't visited before. And so it's a self-discovery as well as the discovery of the outside world.
That's a very fascinating answer that you gave me. Now, you know, that, but once again, it raises another question, is when you're examining yourself and you're comparing yourself to what you used to be and what you have become, you're also obviously taking into account, you know, the situation, the circumstances that have changed and how that have impacted your life. Would you then say that all poetry that has come out of you in the last 6 years has to purely do with the fact that you immigrated from Iran to Canada?
I think I couldn't have written the things that I have written, exactly the same kind of poems, if I was in Iran.
So therefore, Canada has made you a better poet?
It has, definitely.
And then, you know, what you said earlier comes to my mind, is that if your life is not good, then your poetry is getting better.
Yeah.
So isn't there a contradiction in that to be a good artist, you are necessarily going to be inflicting pain upon yourself?
Well, not consciously. I wasn't consciously trying to, like, torture myself or put myself, like, in a position of an unemployed person. I was doing whatever I could. I wasn't getting any job. So, like, there were times that, you know, I think, yes, because an artist who is sitting in their ivory tower and are just inspired by the books that they read, their writing is not visceral. It doesn't connect. It doesn't have the urgency. It leaves you cold because, you know, they have just read books and theories. There were times that I was thinking that would I be able to pay the rent this month? This had not happened to me, like, for more than, like, 2 decades or whatever, because I was working independently.
Well, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but I want to ask a relevant question. This is an experience that practically every newcomer who comes to Canada goes through.
Mm-hmm.
And that would include a lot of artists who also write poetry. How are you different?
I'm not different. I'm just writing about these experiences in English. That's what makes me different. Most immigrants write in their own language. And when I talk to people, some of them kind of expressed the kind of doubt. You know, they said, you know, we've heard of, like, fiction writers who have written in another language and have been successful. We've not heard of poets doing that. You know, and but I had the idea. I mean, even the change of language didn't happen consciously. It just came to me. Like, you know, I automatically started writing in English about a month before I landed, because I was thinking about Canada.
And, did you write poetry in another language while you were in Persia?
Yes, in Persian.
In Persian?
Yeah. I started writing poetry since the age of 10. So obviously at that age, I wrote in Persian.
So what sort of influences have, kind of molded your thinking, your writing?
I guess everything from the books that I have read, both Persian and English, because I studied English.
Were teaching English also?
Yes, I was teaching English literature at universities. All the writers I have read, all the experiences that I have gone through. And also, I guess my personal angle of things, the way I filter things, that makes it different from anyone else, even writing about the same subject.
Do you feel that in Canada, because you come from a different culture, and because you belong to a visible minority, even if you don't claim to be a religious minority, there is a certain level of acceptance of that difference, and therefore you automatically get a certain level of privilege as an artist?
I haven't had that feeling. I wish I did. I have kind of the opposite feeling, if I want to be honest with you. I think my being a visible minority kind of is the reason why it took the poetry community such a long time to acknowledge my contribution. And I think had I not been a person of visible minority, this would have happened much earlier. And even now,
but you know, and I don't disagree with you. I'm not saying that you're wrong. This is the experience that a lot of people have shared with me. But I kind of get this feeling that if you go to Toronto, and you know, you and I have shared a lot of events together, you get this feeling that there is a substantial portion of the audience of the poets, of other performers, who come from very different cultures. Mm-hmm. So Toronto gives you that opportunity to be who you are and be creative and be recognized and, you know, get all the accolades that you can possibly get.
Yes, but on the other hand, I'm not only a person of visible minority, I'm a newcomer. What that means is that I've left all my network back home. I have allies. I have very few friends. And what I mean by friends is that a person I can call and I say, you see, I need someone to take photos at my event. I don't have anyone. Can you come and do that? If they have anything else to do, I'm not anyone's priority. You know what I mean?
Yes.
That's what I mean by friend. A friend would cancel their other appointments and would prioritize me as a friend.
Yes.
I don't have that kind of closely knit group of like friends who can support me anytime. A lot of people support me when they are free. And but when you want to organize events, when you want to spread the word, I've come to realize I can't expect anyone.
But you've done a pretty successful
run. I've done that despite being lonely. And that is actually, putting false humility aside, is because of my potential. You know, I know that's not the norm to say it, but I'm a person, I'm a leader. I'm not a follower, and I'm a person with a lot of talents and skills and power. I would have been able to do much more than I have done had I had a greater support system. I think I've done.
When you say support system, do you also mean that there should be provincial government support or there should be city level support? Is that what you're trying to say?
Everything. I haven't, I know there are grants available, but again, because I'm the only one who runs the event, I don't have time to even apply for grants. I've been asking help from people. So far, nobody has actually done so. And I don't really want to add to whatever I'm doing already, because it's huge work.
Yeah? Oh, it is indeed.
Yeah. So that's what I mean. Like, if I was born here, I would have a better support system, and I would do a better job.
You'd probably not be as good a poet.
Yes, I would probably not be as good a poet. So then, you know, I think probably, I'm not just complaining, but I'm saying that
Toronto... Oh, no, I don't mean that, no.
Yeah, Toronto offers huge opportunities for anyone who wants to take it. But then nobody realizes, because nobody has ever tried this. A lot of newcomers do organize events for their own ethnic community, and that's much easier to do. What I'm doing is I'm bridging the gap between all the different communities. Nobody actually considers me part of their own. Nobody would prioritize me over their own. I was talking to another friend, and we were talking about this situation of double exile. You know, I'm exiled from my ethnic community, and I'm exiled from the mainstream community. So I'm not expecting anyone to help me, but then I'm not feeling that I need to thank anybody for whatever I've done. Because it seems to me that I've done it despite
all the problems that you had to face.
Not because of the help that I got.
Yes. Let's move the discussion specifically to Shabashir. What has been your experience dealing with different cultures and poets from different cultures? Because what I have found every time that I have come, and I unfortunately have not been able to come as frequently as I would want to, is that you're able to put together a package every month which provides you with, you know, variety, innovation, and something that is really, really heartwarming. So I'm sure you must be going through a lot of pains to identify who should be there and to provide a variety. So I want you to explain how you do this.
I go to many events. I would like to say that I rarely ever feature anyone whom I have not heard feature before. So that means I get to a lot of events and I connect with people. And I consider when I want to feature, because you know every time we have two featured poets, two invited poets, and then we do have an open mic as well. What I ask myself is that, you know, what do the two featured poets would get out of this experience? I usually try to pair them with someone even that they don't know, like someone they haven't heard, someone from a totally different community, from a different circle. And I also ask them to bring their community to the event. And I tell them about the spirit of community that we are going to build. And because we are trying to facilitate a cross-cultural dialogue, it won't happen if there are not enough people there. And I also do a lot of publicity, use like online resources, send the event to a lot of listings. So, and all of these like behind the scenes work. And
What do the poets who participate feel after the event? What is the feedback that they give you?
They're very, very positive about that. Like a lot of them start actually collaborations and alliances and long-time friendships after the event. And this is what I want to happen. Because at our event, they discover or they actually share the stage with someone that they haven't met, someone with a different voice from a different ethnic background and probably from a different sexual orientation, the gender. And so, they want, what I feel is that, you know, poetry community actually demands this and wants it because this experience has not happened at this level before. Like we consciously promote diversity. We're not just passively accepting it. It's a different thing. This is an unheard of experience in the poetry community. And it's happening at the grassroots level. And so people, there were poets, young poets who've had their first feature with us. There are established poets like poet laureates in Toronto who are also with us. And all the different poets in between. So we try to be really, truly representative. And just to give you an idea, as an Iranian, I've only, like in all these years, we've featured more than 70 artists, none of them repeated. And I've featured only one Iranian poet so far. Anyone in my position would do differently. So just to give you an idea that I'm spreading the word, and I'm just expanding the circle and bringing more people in. It's not just about me, honestly and truly. And people, when they see the list of our features, they know I don't have to tell them.
Oh yeah. Yes, there is no question about that. No, it is one of the most diverse programs that I have known to exist in the community of creative people. And kudos to you for doing that. I want to now take the conversation to your poetry. You've recently published a collection of poems called the Songs of Exile.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you just explain and talk about how this happened and what the book is all about?
Okay, so the book is Songs of Exile, as you can see.
What does the cover say?
The cover is actually, this is the Persian calligraphy by the Iranian artist Sahar Homami. These are the first lines of the Rumi's Masnavi. So, and the translation is at the back, which tells, listen to the reed's narration, complaining of separations. I thought it would be the best cover for a book of poems by an exile, you know. And these poems have all been written in Canada in the first 5 years that I was here, with the exception of the first one, the very first one that I was thinking about coming to Canada. So, I haven't arranged them thematically because my poems are multi-layered, and I don't write in a, like, it's hard. People might connect with one layer, but then there are all the other layers going on, and it would reduce the poem to one thing, which I wasn't really willing to do. Unfortunately, the publisher actually accepted this the same arrangement that I had in mind, which
who
is chronological.
Is
Guernica Editions.
And is this something that can be available? Why don't you give us information on how people can buy this?
Well, they can order it from their little, you know, local bookstores and kind of support them. They can also get it from, you know, Amazon and, you know, online booksellers. And if they are in Toronto, they can come to my readings and not only get the book, but also get an autograph. So, and they can find me on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn. You just Google me.
Wonderful. I want to now inform our viewers of how I got to know of Bänoo Zan. I attended a poetry reading session that was organized by Farzana Doctor, the Brockton Writers Series, and she was the featured poet. I heard her read a poem called Azan in a Toronto streetcar. I grew up in a Muslim neighborhood. I'm not a Muslim. I do not practice any religion. But I grew up in a neighborhood that had a predominant Muslim culture. Azan was part of my growing up for nearly four decades. And the one thing that I missed when I came here was the sound of Azan. And I heard her read this poem. I went, I spoke to her, and I said, I want to publish your poem on my blog. So Bänoo, I want to kind of request you to read that poem first, and then I'll ask you to talk about the other poems.
Okay, so let's see if I have it by heart, because I usually have it by heart. Azan on a Toronto streetcar. My heart hears it before I do. I start to wazoo in tears, praying to stop praying. The ritual branch of the tree of speech, roots falling like leaves. Years back, in the land of Azans, my disbelieving body shook at the gropings of the lecherous call to piety. In the land of now, this call to freedom by a slave frees me from separations, shackling questions released by love, shaking roots to the falling fruit.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
What is it that, we all come from different backgrounds, and you know, we were talking about, before you came, we were talking about how I see, you know, my city, the birthplace, Bombay, as something that is completely unique in the world. I'm sure that is your experience about a lot of places in Iran. Mm-hmm. What we miss is the fact that we are no longer there. When we go back, that place is no longer what it used to be. So there is going to be this permanent gap which can only be filled with memory and with poetry. I want you to describe how that has shaped your collection.
A lot of poems in this collection have references to experiences that I've had, but in a way, as you said, in the remembered experience, as Wordsworth says, poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings recollected in tranquility. So that's exactly how these poems happen. Like when I'm here and I'm reading the news and I see that like Iran is being threatened with attacks because of its nuclear program and all that kind of thing, and I'm talking to people and people are saying, you know what, maybe this should happen because, you know, Iran is like that. And I'm thinking, are you aware of what you're talking about? You're talking about 80 million people. Yeah. And once you attack a country, you're not actually attacking any of those politicians who make those decisions. You're attacking people on the streets, and those people, a lot of them are people that I know. My students, my family, their families, my students' families, and the people who have nothing to do with anything, just they're living in that land. And you're talking about a land of fascinating culture and background, and you know, it seems that, like the poem Iran, when I wrote?
Which is what I was going to come to.
Yeah,
I want you to recite that poem, because that is an extremely moving and, you know, a very poignant poem. I want you to, you know, if you can, please recite that for us.
Sure. I am forced, stripped down to a handful of dust, the waves of my hair shorn, hands and feet tied down to Procrustean borders of subjection, my vagina bleeding in explosions of testosterone. I'm witness to my archetypal nightmare, my sons lusting after me in incestuous copulations of power, my daughters offering me to rapists as a scapegoat. I'm alluring to invaders who demand fake orgasmic pleasure in denial of pain, a prostitute smile I cannot afford, thirsting after my dark juices to keep their industrious phalluses going. No one hears me in this gang rape, and when mock trials are staged, I'm called to testify against myself. I'm a terrorist to colonialists. I terrify ugliness with independent beauty. Accused of profanity, I dance lifeless on sacred gallows. Like Tahmineh, I have bedded heroes who have slain the young. Like Jocasta, I have bedded heroes who have slain the old, and this is not my first time. I'm woman with history. You, who stand in line, waiting for your turn, you cannot maintain that erection forever.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
That is absolutely fascinating. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for sharing your views and reciting your poems.
And thank you and all the TAG TV team and all your wonderful audience. It was a pleasure to be here and to share my experience.
Friends, this is Bänoo Zan, poet and a cultural organizer of a lovely, lovely series that has been going on for the last 4 or 5 years. You're watching TAG TV. This is Living Multiculturalism with Mayank Bhatt. The program is brought to you by the Canadian Thinkers Forum. Friends, I always end this program with a request. Write to us. We need your inputs. Tell us who you want to see. Tell us who you want to interact with, and we will have them here. Thank you for being with us. Till the next time, good day.
Number 1 multicultural channel. This is TAG TV.